The System Administration MiniConf and our second presentation of the morning or the evening. We've now reached the US in our presenters, so we are into evening rather than the middle of the night. Up now talking is Michael talking about administrating Ceph clusters. Over to you, Michael.
Thank you very much. As in the introduction, we're going to be going over a couple of things regarding tips and tricks for managing and administering Ceph clusters. Just a real quick background on me on why I think I am able to give this talk to everybody today. I've been working storage over 15 years, specifically Ceph with 5 years. I work for Red Hat currently in their product experience department, in which I work hand in hand with our product management and engineering teams in support, supporting our Ceph product. So I do a lot of the pushing in regards to getting fixes out to our customers that require these needed enhancements or bug fixes. So why are we all here today? Couple of prerequisites on this talk where there's no deep knowledge required here for Ceph. The only requirement is that you have a want to want to know more about Ceph and have a deep need to kind of get a general understanding of what we have available for software-defined storage with Ceph. I'm going to be covering Ceph at ADM and usage basics around Ceph ADM, in particular the deployment of a Ceph cluster using Ceph ADM. We'll also take a look at the new embedded Ceph dashboard, as it's in my opinion, it's really cool and one of the great new usability features with Ceph. A highlight here is we're not going to be covering anything with Rook Ceph or the Ceph operator for Kubernetes. I want to call that out because with Kubernetes being the hot topic now, I just want to highlight none of that's going to be covered here. So what is Ceph ADM? So in short, Ceph ADM deploys and manages a Ceph cluster by connecting the hosts from the manager via SSH. This allows us to add or remove or update Ceph daemon containers all using this one tool set. And we don't rely on any external configuration or orchestration tools like we did in the past, like Ceph Ansible, Rook, or Salt. Ceph ADM is also a tool that's actually going to manage the full lifecycle of your Ceph cluster, starting off from the beginning by bootstrapping the installation of a tiny Ceph cluster, a single node, and then using the Ceph orchestration interface, which we'll get into in the next couple slides. You might be familiar with these as the day two aspect of Ceph, or day two aspect of any system administration. And we're going to use that to expand the cluster to start adding hosts and provisioning other daemons like monitors and OSDs and your client daemons and services to use the cluster. Ceph ADM can be used either via the command line interface or once installed, you can actually use the dashboard in order. And once installed in Bootstrap, you can actually use the dashboard to just click and add hosts and different services as you choose via the graphical interface. Ceph ADM is new in the Octopus release of Ceph, and we don't currently support any other lower versions than Octopus with Ceph ADM. So what's the goal here? Why was Ceph ADM developed? The main goal here was to provide a fully featured, well-maintained installation and management tool that can be used for anybody not running Ceph in Kubernetes. Basically, we're saying anybody because the aspect of this tool is simplicity and quickness, getting a Ceph cluster up and running quickly and getting the daemons deployed in an equal quick fashion. So some of the goals that were set forth with this tool is to deploy an entire Ceph cluster inside containers. Why are we using containers? So the reason we chose to use containers is because it's going to simplify management and dependency of all the package burdens across multiple different distributions, RHEL, Ubuntu, SUSE, multiple different distributions. Package management is also set with a single container. Pushing towards a tight integration with the orchestrator API, CephOrch. The orchestrator interface has evolved along with the development of Ceph ADM in order to match all of the functionality and features that we actually put in the Ceph Rook. So it's actually a very close resemblance between Ceph Rook and Ceph ADM. like I said before, no dependency on management tools. The reason why we did this, I mean, Ceph is great, Salt is great, Ceph Ansible is great, but the reason why this was done is when we make Ceph depend on these types of tools, it means that there's more than one piece of software that the user is actually going to have to learn. Ceph as a whole is a large part of is a great amount of learning, but when we stack on having to learn Ansible in order to deploy a Ceph cluster, that can be too much of a burden for some system admins. So the goal here is to give a single management tool for management and deployment of Ceph clusters. Like I stated previously, minimum OS dependencies. Basically, the only requirements for CephADM from a dependency standpoint on the hosts are Python 3, LVM, and any type of container runtime service like Podman or Docker. Any modern Linux distribution will actually do. Isolating clusters from each other is another big goal here. The reason why we have this is because in the past, if you were using Ceph Ansible or say Ceph Deploy to deploy Ceph clusters and doing multiple Ceph clusters, there were multiple issues you would encounter there. The use of Ceph Admin actually allows us to separate clusters into to separate areas and actually shell into certain clusters and manage those clusters all from the same node. So multiple clusters on a single node. Automated upgrades is also great because we're pushing that Ceph is actually going to own a deployment and own a responsibility for upgrading the cluster in a safe and automated fashion. And then finally, pushing for an easy migration from our legacy deployment tools like Ceph Deploy and Ceph Ansible into the CephADM. So basically, there will be a conversion period on these upgrades where CephADM will be able to take over an existing cluster that was deployed on a legacy tool to be managed by CephADM. So just running through a quick install here, I want to show you that it really is that simple. As I stated, to install a Ceph cluster within a 5 to 10 minute time frame. Basically, I like to call it a three-step process, mainly because a lot of these steps documented here are that I'm showing in the slide are prerequisites and could be done before a Ceph cluster. But basically, it's basically fetching a script, bootstrapping your nodes, adding each one of the new hosts into that into your cluster via the orchestrator, and then adding your OSDs. It's as simple as that. Bootstrapping is basically just a process of creating a monitor and manager daemon on the single new on the single node. We generate a key. We pass that key to into a pub file in etc/ceph. We write a minimal configuration file. We copy the secret key for a client admin key into etc/ceph, and we spin up the monitor container and the manager container. This default bootstrap behavior that I show you in this slide in these six steps is actually going to work for the majority of our users. As soon as you run through this, at this point, you can access the cluster via a shell container from CephADM, or basically just run the script from inside the directory. So in those six steps, this is just going to be a basic overview of how this works. This is after completion of running your bootstrap script. This occurs once you install the script. You run your Ceph your CephADM command to deploy the bootstrap. You literally have a cluster in about 2 minutes with a single mon manager and a dashboard daemon running. And at this point, you can actually log into the Ceph dashboard and actually view your Ceph cluster. We have our SSH connection to interact with the secondary host, which we're going to be adding, which is basically just using a CephADM command, add host, and we have another mon manager deployed. Adding a third, all you need is basically the host name and to add that node into the cluster. The nodes will automatically get added as monitor nodes due to the fact that we have a system limit set when we add these nodes. The default is 5. So the first 5 nodes added will go in as monitors. You can edit that to limit it to 3 if you're going to have a smaller cluster and only require 3 monitors. So that's step two, basically, out of the additional nodes, which come in as monitors. And then step three is basically going in and adding in your OSDs. It's basically the same cephadm command, but you can go in and use an activate all command, which means basically that cephadm will go in, Ceph Orchestrator will go in and look at all the devices available on these nodes and go in and deploy OSDs against every single one of these nodes. If you want to know more on cephadm, I suggest you look through the documentation. It's some vast documentation. It'll give you a great background. So what is the Ceph dashboard? I talked a bit about this in the cephadm install. And the reason why I brought it up is because by default, the Ceph dashboard gets installed automatically when you bootstrap a cluster. This is a web-based management tool, which is largely cleaned up than what we had in our past dashboard revisions. If anybody that's been around with Ceph for a long time remembers the Calamari dashboard, this is a vast improvement over that, including the ability to manage and add daemons and things of that nature. So this is a slide that talks a lot into basically how the dashboard works. But simply put, if you deploy a Ceph cluster on Octopus, you're going with cephadm, you'll get the Ceph dashboard by default, unless you specify with an argument during the cluster install to basically not install the dashboard. The dashboard is going to be running inside the Ceph manager, and we'll use other Ceph manager modules like Prometheus and Grafana for scraping data and putting it into the graphs on the dashboard. Prometheus and Grafana will be running in containerized services on your nodes. So they will be they'll be containerized services in there. It's like your alert manager, which will push alerts towards the dashboard, and then also your Prometheus for scraping each one of the data points on the nodes. The documentation for the dashboard is fantastic, and I suggest you have a look at it if you're interested in more of what the dashboard can do, because it's a large improvement over what we had previously in regards to user management as well as what's available inside the dashboard. With the time I have left, I wanted to run through a couple of these dashboard slides, because one of the biggest complaints we get with Ceph, working support for a number of years on the Ceph product, is it's tough to troubleshoot. The dashboard really shines in this area, and also helps alleviate problem nodes or problem disks inside clusters. This is the host overall performance view, which is basically an aggregate of CPU busy, RAM utilization, and things along those lines for the entire host environment inside your cluster. You can actually drill down in each one of your hosts on your cluster and get further details in regards to number of OSDs, for example, the raw capacity for those OSDs on the disks. A popular panels for our customers have actually been a lot of the network work, the network panels. As you can see, we actually show drop rate and error rate on the NICs for the specified public networks for your Ceph cluster. So when troubleshooting flapping OSDs, for example, this could be a great pain in order to go and look at for those types of troubles. Also, throughput by disks is great, so you can look for any type of hotspots on a node in your cluster. Pool performance stats is also fairly important, as you can see one of the main panels here. Top 15 client IOPS by pool, so you can listen for those noisy neighbor clients, which are basically hammering pools, which if you're sharing crush rule sets inside your Ceph cluster, could be impacting other clients in the cluster. So this is another great area in the dashboard to look at. And then one of my personal favorites, being an RGW specialist, is the RGW performance stats. These are improving with every update we do to the dashboard, due to the large amount of object users out there. And when investigating any type of RGW performance issues, this is a great area in the dashboard to use. I also want to highlight your sync performance tab here. This is for multi-site, where you can actually see the sync rate between your sites. That's been difficult in the past to determine using a Rados Gateway admin command in order to do that, and having this graph is helpful in that troubleshooting standpoint. Thank you very much. I hope I push some ideas towards Ceph, and if you have any further information on it, please look to the links that I put inside the talk.
Thank you very much. We will try and get those slides up as soon as possible so that you can have a look at the links directly. And hopefully Michael will have a chance to jump into the chat in Venulus and answer any questions that you might have. Thank you for the talk, Michael. We now have a break, and then hopefully our next speaker, Federico, will be talking to us about Raspberry Pi clusters. Thank you. See you in 10 minutes.